So we've examined how biochemists were attacking the nature of DNA replication and describing the enzymology of DNA replication. And during the same time period, though, it wasn't clear exactly what made a gene up, besides that it was made up of DNA. For example, was a gene a single base pair of DNA, or was it a longer stretch of DNA? What exactly constituted a gene? And so geneticists in the late 1950s then were working out the nature of the gene by examining mutations and the behavior of mutations that affected the same gene. So let's look at some of these experiments. The first set of experiments dealt with fungi, and fungi can form diploid organisms that will form spores under certain conditions. And here are three different fungal species, and this shows the diploid spores that can be generated called conidia. These are the conidia. And those spores then can germinate and reconstitute fungi that are diploid, which can undergo meiotic divisions. But right now we're considering only the diploid phase. So these conidia are diploid. And this last photograph here is of Aspergillus, which was an organism that was employed to examine the fine structure of the gene through recombination. So some investigators were looking at, for example, one example, Pritchard et al. Were looking at mutations that affected the ability of the conidia that were released from the diploid genotype to grow in the absence of added adenine. So there were a bunch of mutations that had been obtained that prevented the growth unless the medium was supplemented with adenine. And so we're going to focus in on this adenine gene here. And these genes, the yellow gene and the biotin gene, are just outside markers, if you will, outside genes that are outside this adenine-requiring gene. So mutants like ADD8 and ADD16 show an inability to grow on medium that lacks supplemented adenine, and that's when you have homozygous mutations. So that makes sense. If you're homozygous for a mutation in the biochemical pathway that allows you to manufacture adenine, then it makes sense that you would require adenine in the media to grow if you're homozygous for this mutation. Well, it turned out, though, that some very interesting results were obtained, which indicated that the gene was a linear structure and not a single base pair. And that was the following. Actually, you could look at this genotype as more of, in this designation here, more like this designation, where the adenine 8 mutation in the gene was at a different location in the gene than adenine 16. Now, of course, this wasn't known at the time, but led to the discovery that the experiments that I'm describing led to the discovery that this must have been the type of arrangement within the gene. And the ability to detect recombination within a gene was made possible by being able to score large numbers of progeny conidia that would result from recombination events, mitotic recombination events, between this mutation in an adenine gene and this mutation in an adenine gene. So let's just imagine now that recombination occurs within a gene and recombines these alleles such that the adenine 8 allele would be joined to the adenine 16 allele, and the wild type alleles for that gene would also be joined together on the same chromosome. And note that if that event happened, could detect that that was a true recombination event by the positioning of the outside marker genes, in this case, yellow conidia and a biotin requiring a mutation versus their wild type alleles. So, by observing the phenotypes of large numbers of conidia on media require the, I'm sorry, on media supplemented with adenine or media without supplemented adenine, it was observed that at some low frequency you could obtain conidia that in fact could grow on adenine minus media that lacked adenine. And that was because we were basically heterozygous for both of these mutant alleles of the gene, and we were able to restore a functional gene. And lots of experiments along these lines showed that we could get intragenic recombination, implying that the gene was a linear structure. It wasn't just a single base pair, because you would not be able to get recombination then if mutations were, if a gene was a single base pair, you could not recombine alleles as shown here. So this led to the notion that indeed the gene was a linear structure and comprised a stretch of nucleotides of the DNA molecule. Now, this was brought home even in a more dramatic case by the experiments working with bacteriophage, specifically bacteriophage T4. And just to jog your memory here, you remember that bacteriophage have a protein coat that in the head encapsulates a DNA molecule, and a protein protein sheath, the protein base plate, and for some phage, tail fibers that are also protein. So basically, the bacteriophage is made out of protein and DNA and nothing else, essentially. And here's an electron micrograph of bacteriophage or phage T4. And here's another electron micrograph showing the head, the tail, and I'm sorry, the tail fibers, and then the sheath. And this is also known as a collar. This area is the collar. And here is the base plate. And you might want to review how it is that bacteriophage infect bacteria, but we'll go over that very briefly. So let's look at that. We see that phage attach to the outside of bacteria and inject their DNA into the interior of the cell. And that DNA then subverts the host machinery so as to produce replicas of the phage. That is, we have transcription of the phage genes, which encode the various phage proteins, and those proteins and replicated DNA that ensues through this cycle that we call the lytic cycle, because it's going to result in the lysis of the bacterium. These phage are assembled spontaneously once we have the components of the phage manufactured in the infection cycle, such that we have phage proteins and phage DNA, which self-assemble into phages, intact bacteriophage particles, which then, when numerous enough, cause lysis of the host cell and releasing progeny phage that can go and infect another bacterium. And when you infect bacteria with phage and plate those bacteria, what you see is a lawn of bacteria shown as kind of a muddy area here. And then you see clear round areas that represent the infection of a bacterium with a single bacteriophage and the subsequent lysis of that bacteria and surrounding bacteria by the progeny phage that are being produced through subsequent lytic cycles. So each one of these little plaques, we call these plaques, each one of these little round clear areas being a plaque, it might contain, say, a million bacteriophage particles, but might be initiated by the infection of a single bacterium by a single bacteriophage. And so you can see that we can get large numbers of bacteriophage on just small petri dishes that contain a lawn of bacteria. And this was exploited to investigate the nature of the gene. Here we have different phenotypes of plaques that are grown on bacteria, so that you can see that you can in fact score the genotypes of bacteriophage by looking at the plaque morphologies that form on lawns of bacteria. And in particular, we're going to focus on the R gene here. Specifically, we'll call it the R2 gene. And here we have an R minus mutation in a bacteriophage. We see very large plaques. The R mutation causes a rapid lysis of cells and leads to larger plaques compared to R wild type, which leads to smaller plaques. And right now we're not going to worry about this other gene here, the H gene. So R minus mutations cause large plaques on certain bacteria and small plaques on those same bacteria. And this ability to define plaque morphology was exploited by a phage geneticist, Seymour Benzer, at the California Institute of Technology. And after his phage work later in life, he moved on to studying fruit flies, my favorite organism, and did some very beautiful work on the neurobiology of fruit flies. but we're concerned with his early work on the nature of the gene studying bacteriophage. So let's look at some of the experiments that Benzer utilized to define the nature of a gene. So what Benzer did first was to utilize the ability to do co-infections of bacteria. So if we have a bacterium here which we're going to infect with phage, we can do co-infections of bacteria with phage. So we can have phage of one genotype here, infecting, injecting its DNA into the host. And we'll say the genotype of this phage is such that its chromosome, when injected into the bacterium, is a mutant in, we'll call it mutant A here, and we'll say at a second position that it is wild type, just for an initial consideration. And here's another bacteriophage that we can co-infect with bacterium, and we'll say its chromosome is wild type, where the other chromosome is mutant for A, and it has a mutation in B. And it turns out that the R mutants that we're going to consider here, the R gene, in addition to the phenotypes on growth on bacteria, in which it forms, mutants form large plaques and wild type forms small plaques, in addition to that, there's another phenotype. And that is that any of the R2 mutants that Benzer had available, and he had thousands of them available to him actually, R2 minus mutants, so we'll just say minus equals mutation here, R2 minus mutants do not grow on strain K of bacteria. They do not grow, whereas they do grow on strain B. Whereas the wild type genes for R2 confer an ability of the phage to grow on both K and B. And this phenotype allowed for the isolation of thousands of mutations in R2 genes, because you could screen for mutations that would not grow on strain K, that is, they would not form plaques on strain K, but would on B. And when you had that, you had an R2 mutant. You knew you had a mutant. Now, what Benzer first discovered by co-infection is that when he made combinations of did co-infections of bacteria in the following manner, where a mutant of A and a mutant of B were mixed, you could establish plaques. Plaques would be, lysis would occur just fine. That is, phage would emerge just fine. And so whatever this was, wild type was supplying functions, let's call it function A, and this one was providing, say, function B, and together those wild type alleles allowed for growth, allowed for lysis and growth even on strain K. This is strain K bacteria. Whereas either of these alone would not grow on strain K. So somehow this gene here was supplying an ability of a function B, and this wild type allele was supplying a function A that would allow the growth on strain K. And so what Benzer did was to characterize large numbers of R2 mutants that by themselves could not grow on strain K. He characterized their ability to provide functions that would allow other mutants in combination to grow. So these co-infection experiments are key to Benzer's studies. So keep in mind the co-infection paradigm that I just laid out for you, and in the next lecture we'll consider the results of Seymour Benzer's studies on the R2 region of phage T4.